I bought these USB-C charger modules from AliExpress, and because of two missing resistors, these don't work with proper USB-C power supply. I think this is a great opportunity to demonstrate how I reverse engineer PCBs. I will be using KiCAD 7, which has new background image feature, which should help this process quite a lot. This video is sponsored by PCBWay.com, who sent me the PCBs that I designed when practicing for this video. PCBWay.com offers basic PCBs starting from just $5 plus shipping for 10 pieces of 100x100mm PCBs. Here are samples of some, but not all, of the different color options available. If your project requires more advanced PCBs, 3D printed parts, or CNC milled parts, don't worry, you can order them from PCBWay.com as well. For all your prototyping and low volume production needs, go check out PCBWay.com for up-to-date information on their offering. This is a destructive method. I have taken one module, I've removed all the components, measured each component, what the value is, what the package is, and then I have sanded all the solder mask away from the PCB, making all the traces more visible. When I have all the components identified, including the values and packages, I add them to KiCAD schematic editor. I give components same values and designators, reference numbers as on the original PCB, so when I can place them easily in correct places. I have all the components in this editor, but they are not connected together. If I can see on the original PCB that some parts are connected together, I can try to place them close to each other here, but that's not necessary right now. This is all I'm doing in the schematic editor for now. Before any connections are made, I'll prepare things on the layout editor. Like usually, I update PCB from schematic, automatically adding the footprints to the PCB, from tools update PCB from schematic, or by pressing F8. I'm going to jump back and forth between schematic editor and PCB editor, so I'll always read the changes that are going to be applied, so nothing will be deleted by an accident. This is giving me quite few errors, but they are all because of some connections not found or used in the USB-C connector. I'm going to ignore these for now, I think these will be fixed later. Now all the components are on the PCB editor. I'll place them somewhere for now and start importing the photos. While front copper layer is selected, I will add photo of front side of PCB using place add image. The photo of backside is flipped to make all the holes align with non-mirrored front side. The photo looks good, but it's too big. It needs to be scaled down. After selecting the image, the dimensions are shown on the bottom left corner. This image is 42.08mm, while the actual PCB is 20.18mm. Double-clicking the photo, there's scaling factor on image tab. I'll change it to actual PCB height divided by the height KiCAD said the photo was. Now the photo looks to be correct size. I'll double-click it and lock it. Then it can't be selected or edited by an accident. Then I'll select bottom copper layer and import the backside photo and scale it by similar way. Aligning the photos takes some trial and error. Easiest way of moving one of the photos by very small amount is to double click it and change its numerical position. Making vias line up as well as possible is the goal. Misalignment of less than half of via diameter isn't a problem. Once I'm happy with the alignment, I'm going to lock the second photo as well. Now I can bring the components closer and start placing them to their correct places. We will always encounter things like photo not being 100% straight, the component's patch shape not matching the ones on the PCB, and so on. We will be drawing all the tracks manually, so patch of the actual components touching wrong parts of the photo isn't really an issue. It's fine as long as we can visually see which pads are supposed to be connected to which copper tracks. First component, the USB-C jack, is now placed. Next obvious parts are the ICs. Looking at the original populated PCB to check the orientation of these components and Here the batch sizes have significant size difference. Batch of this footprint are almost 1.5 times the size of the original. But looking at the surrounding of the chip, this size difference won't cause any confusion when figuring out the connections. I'll place rest of the components to their original places. Just like when giving values to components in schematic editor, here it is important to place the components to same places. Check the reference numbers of components and see where it was in the original PCB. In this circuit, most parts are resistors and capacitors that can be placed either way. But the LEDs have polarity. This footprint doesn't have clear indicator which pad is anode and which is cathode. But zooming in, I can see the net name of each pad. One has K in it for cathode and one has A for anode. Now I have placed all the components and I can start figuring out the connection. Especially because some of the pads are larger than original, they might be blocking our view. On the left toolbar, there are buttons for showing pads, vias, traces, and copper zones in outline mode. This makes those elements see-through and we can see the photo underneath them. These will become useful especially when we have added some traces and copper zones. I'll start making the connections. Here is for example easy one, short trace connecting only these two pads, which I've selected by holding Ctrl key and clicking them. While they are selected, I will jump to the schematic editor and see which pins are highlighted. I can see one of them is TP4056 pin number 2 named Brock, and top end of the R3 resistor is the second one. I will move the R3 closer to the IC and wire the pins that were highlighted previously. Anytime I'm making modifications on the schematic editor, I will hit F8 to update those changes to the PCB editor. List of changes should list connections between those pins I just wired together. And again, there are some errors, but they are not related to those changes. These are related to the USB-C jack I'm using. Now on the PCB editor, there is an IR wire between previously selected pads and I can route a trace between them. If unsure of what kind of current will flow on these traces, I will try to match the width of the original trace. Quick way of changing traces width is with Q key while routing a trace. Next obvious connection I'm seeing is the other end of the resistor, which is connected to the large copper zone. That is also connected to USB connector's metal case and two pads. All those are ground. In this case, it's good idea to label that signal as ground. I'll use the usual ground symbol on the schematic editor. This makes it simple to add more connections to ground later on. Again, always when modifications have been made, F8 updates the changes to the PCB editor. Only few of these pins on the USB-C connector are actually used, but unused pins have pads assigned to them. To make routing easier, I'm going to remove unused pads. This allows routing other wires under those pins, while the solder mask will keep the pins away from those tracks. Right-clicking the components and selecting Open in Footprint Editor allows editing this footprint on this project without affecting the original library. In Footprint Editor, I select unused pads and hit Delete to remove them. Now there is much more space to route things near the connector. Speaking of, I will now add two 5.1 kilo ohm resistors, one from CC1 to ground and one from CC2 to ground. I will add them in schematic editor just like usually when making schematics. In schematic editor, I'll delete extra pins of USB-C connector same way as I deleted pads on the PCB editor. Jumping to PCB editor with F8, I can start placing the new resistors. There is one trace on the photo that isn't actually used. I can ignore the diagonal trace that is located near the USB-C connector's pads. I will do some modifications and place new resistors between the connector and the IC. Capacitor C3 needs to be moved, but it seems to be connected between ground and VCC of TP4056, so I can move it as long as I keep it close to those pins. Once I have room for the new resistors, I'll place them where I want it and route the traces from USB-C connector. There are many connections to ground already, and I'm going to use filled copper zones to connect them. I will now draw board outline to edge cut layer, and then add copper zone to both front and back copper layers assigned to ground net. The footprint of TP4056 doesn't have thermal vias, which are on the original PCB, so I will add manually as many vias as I can easily fit under the chip. Then I'll connect few pads that have trays going on both sides of the PCB. I'll change the zone visibility to outline mode, and then start connecting these trays from pin 4 of TP4056. I'll start routing from that pin to via, hit V to add the via and change to other side of the PCB. There I will follow trace to another via, and it seems to go to front side of the PCB to a pad that wasn't populated, so I can undo previous and skip that via. Here was the via I'm going to ignore, as it was unused. Instead, I follow this trace with thicker trace to another via, switching to another side of the PCB and checking where that leads to. Here I can see the VCC pin of USB-C connector is connected to the trace I'm drawing, which connects to pin 4 of TP4056. Also, one side of R8 is connected to this VCC. I will add VCC label on the schematic editor to all of these connected pads, and then I can route those pads together. It's not possible to start routing with thick wire right from the connector because of other pads close by. In these cases, I start routing with thinner wire and change to thicker wire as soon as possible. At this point, I have done each required step at least once. Rest is repeating previous steps as required. It's lots of manual repeating work. But at the end, I have copy of original PCB on my PCB editor. But the clone of the PCB isn't the main reason I do this kind of reverse engineering. It's the schematic that I'm after. By studying the schematic, we can find how everything works. This can be used to repair similar devices, modify them, or even create replacement circuits. In the end, I managed to create a fixed version of this module I bought from AliExpress. If I wasn't doing this for this demonstration video, I would probably have started from scratch and designed my own charger module. The new background image feature in KiCAD 7 isn't a magical tool, but it does indeed simplify this process. Hopefully this demonstration was useful. Thanks for watching. See you next video. Bye.